Yes, so welcome everybody. Today we are very fortunate. It's a pleasure for me to introduce Silvia Pascoli. She got a PhD from CISA, where I am now in my office, in 2002. Then she did the postdoc first at UCLA and then at CERN. Since I think 2005, she got a faculty position at Durham University. And recently, since 2020, she moved to Italy as a professor, full professor at the University of Bologna. She's a world expert in many aspects of neutrino physics. So today, I think we are fortunate to have her tell us about many topics. So neutrinos from past surprises to current puzzles. So without further ado, I leave the floor to Silvia. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot for this very kind invitation. I mean, it's a pleasure to discuss a little bit neutrinos. They are very, very interesting particles. They are still the least known of all the standard model particles, at least the fermions. And through even from their conception as one of the elementary particles, they indeed presented us with puzzles and anomalies that we had to understand. So this is the focus of my talk today. As you know, neutrinos are extremely copiously produced both on Earth and in astrophysical objects. So we have huge fluxes of neutrinos from the sun, from supernovas, and then we can study to try to understand the neutrino properties. And I'd like to make one piece of advert, the Neutrinoscope app that you can find freely on the App Store if you want to kind of visualize how neutrinos are around us, neutrino fluxes from reactors, from the sun, and so on and so forth. Now, coming to a more particle physics perspective on neutrinos, they are indeed extremely interesting. First of all, neutrinos present what is the biggest surprise for many years in our understanding of elementary interactions, because neutrinos have been discovered to have mass. I will comment on this. This is really very important because this is so far the only particle physics evidence that the standard model is incomplete and somehow has to be extended to a more general theory, which will include also the explanation of the origin of neutrino masses. And indeed, as I already said, they are the least known of the standard model particles. In fact, they could be a portal to dark sectors. I want to introduce kind of this concept, and I will discuss that later in the talk, which will be kind of a possible question mark of maybe neutrinos are really giving us the biggest surprise of all, being a portal to a new low energy extension of the standard model. But this is clearly a big question mark that we have at the moment. Neutrinos are related really to the deep properties of nature, in particular to the symmetries of nature. In fact, we have no time to discuss this really in this talk, but the nature of neutrinos, whether they are Dirac or Majorana particles, and I will mention neutrinos of beta decay, is related to the conservation of lot of lepton numbers. So we are thinking now of hunting for the ultimate theory of particles in the interactions, and we want to extend the standard model, then we should kind of consider if such an extension preserves or not the lepton number, which is an accidental symmetry of the standard model. It's not a fundamental symmetry of it. They have also very important consequences from a cosmological point of view. In fact, they are the most abundant fermions, at least that we know of. And of course, they had impact on their evolution at several times. I will mention only in passing that we can use this impact on large-scale structure formation to deduce information on neutrino masses. And they can as well be related to and the baryon asymmetry of the universe. So really they are really very rich in the implications and the impact they have on our understanding of particles. Now let me start with just the basics. Neutrinos, what are they and how they fit in the standard model? Well, they fit extremely well. Neutrinos come in terms of left-handed particles. This was probably the one of the big surprises. All the other fermions come in two versions, left-handed and right-handed particles, and we can write down a Dirac-Mass term for them. Neutrinos instead have been discovered only as left-handed particles. We have not seen a right-handed component, and this fits very, very well within within the standard model. Each neutrino is associated to a charged lepton. In fact, we can establish the type of a charged lepton, so whether it's an electron, a muon, or a tau, distinguishing them by their mass. But we know the flavor of the neutrino only because it is associated to the charged lepton. So if we see in an interaction, an electron, for instance, involved, then we know that we have an electron neutrino to deal with. If it is a muon, we have a muon neutrino, and so on and so forth. In particular, from an SU2 of cage structure, they come as doublets, in doublets with the charged leptons. And in fact, they do interact via the charge current and the neutral current Lagrangian with the W and the Z. I will be mainly concerned about charge current interactions because these allow actually to test the flavor of the neutrino. And they carry lepton number like the charged leptons. This is very important because, for example, Majorana-mass terms break lepton number directly, as neutrinos do carry this quantum number. So this is the picture in the standard model. Already the introduction of the concept of the neutrino by Pauli in the 30s was already a kind of surprise, but it solved very nicely the problem of beta decays, where the spectrum of the electrons coming out of the decays is continuum rather than monochromatic line. And then the kind of the development or understanding of neutrinos presented all these subsequent surprises, the fact that they are left-handed and how they fit in the standard model. But what was even more puzzling was that there were some anomalies starting from the 50s, which were kind of taking more and more significance over the years. So as we know, the neutrinos are produced in weak interactions, in particular in beta decays. It was known that a large amount of electron neutrinos are produced in the sun, in the PP and the CNO cycles. And then, so one could try to detect this flux of electron neutrinos on Earth. And this was the goal of the first of this experiment, really a pioneering experiment in this, the Olmsted experiment. And this consistently detected a number of neutrinos much lower than what expected from the prediction. So for many years, there were discussions about the validity of our theoretical modeling of the production of neutrinos in the sun, and overall, the understanding of the evolution in the sun. There were other anomalies building in a different area, looking at atmospheric neutrinos instead. Atmospheric neutrinos are neutrinos produced when cosmic rays hit the atmosphere, producing lots of pions and kaons. Pions decay into muon neutrinos and muons. And so you expect a large flux of muon neutrinos. But now if you look at the number of neutrinos which that are coming down, so they are produced in the atmosphere and then travel to the detector, typically 10 kilometers or so. And instead you look at neutrinos which come from the other side of the Earth. We know that neutrinos are very weakly interacting, so they can cross the Earth essentially barely feeling it. So they can travel then 10,000 kilometers and reach the detector and be detected there. So if you look at these downgoing and upgoing neutrinos, muon neutrinos, you see a difference there. The number of upgoing neutrinos is significantly lower than the downgoing ones, and with a dependence on the distance they have traveled. All of these indications, which actually led to the Nobel Prizes that I've indicated here, Davis for his experiment, Homestake, Koshiba for the Kamiokande experiment detecting the first supernova neutrinos from supernova 1987A, and then Kajita for the super Kamiokande experiment and McDonald for the snow experiment. The Nobel Prize in Physics in 2015, in fact, recognized the importance of the detection of neutrino oscillations. This is only roughly 20 years ago, Super Kamiokande reported the discovery of neutrino oscillations at 5 sigma in 1998, exactly looking at this difference between downgoing and upgoing neutrinos, muon neutrinos. Of course, at that point, you didn't know if these were oscillations or some other strange property of neutrinos. Maybe they could decay or traveling long distances or some other strange effects. It was, there's no experiment that I'm depicting here in 2002, which instead was able to measure the total flux of neutrinos coming from the sun. So not only the electron neutrinos, but as well the muon and the tau neutrinos via neutral current interactions, and confirmed that indeed, in charge current interactions, you see a much smaller number of electron neutrinos. However, these have oscillated into muons and new taus, and if you go and look at the full flux, this is roughly 3 times higher, and telling you that the indeed new E's have oscillated into new mu's and new taus. So this is very important result. Why neutrino oscillations are so important, as I will explain after doing a small exercise in quantum mechanics, neutrino oscillations mean that neutrinos have mass and mix. And this is a departure from the standard model, because the standard model per se containing only left-handed neutrinos and satisfying the standard model gauge interactions cannot explain neutrino masses. So what are neutrino oscillations? Well, the first idea was put forward by Bruno Portecorvo in 57 and then subsequently developed theoretically. And essentially neutrino oscillations are the change of one flavor of neutrino to another flavor as they travel over large distances. And I like to call them Chanalian particles for that. So let's do this kind of exercise in quantum mechanics. First of all, we need to introduce the concept of mixing. So let's look at a flavor neutrino, for example, a new E or a new mu or a new tau. This is one way to describe neutrinos, but we have another basis, like quantum mechanics, you can have different bases to describe your state. The other basis is the mass basis. This is the basis in which neutrinos have a given mass. So we have nu one, nu two, nu three. So you see already that kind of this is the basis relevant for neutrino production and detection. This is the basis relevant instead for neutrino propagation. And the two are connected by a unitary mixing matrix called the Pontecorvo-Makinagawa-Sakata matrix. This matrix, of course, enters into the charge current Lagrangian in the basis in which the charge leptons are diagonal. This mixing matrix will enter here, relating the mass neutrinos to the charge leptons. So what does this imply from a physical point of view? So if we have a charge current interaction, for example, a W, which produces a positron and electron neutrino, this electron neutrino is actually the coherent superposition of the mass states, nu one, nu two, and nu three, with each weight given by the mixing matrix. But just a comment about this mixing matrix that I will talk about these angles. This 3x3 matrix is parameterized in terms of three angles. Here, S23 means the sine of the angle theta 23. C23 is the cosine of theta 23, and similarly for the angle theta 13 and the angle theta 12. All these angles enter in different ways in different experiments. And so, as I will show you later, we have now a very kind of precise picture of that. We have also CP violating phases, the delta phase here, and these two Majorana phases. These signal CP violation, meaning that if you're looking at antineutrinos, antineutrinos will behave with the complex conjugate of this matrix. And so potentially, if U is non-real, is imaginary, potentially this could lead to a different behavior of neutrinos and antineutrinos. So let's look back now. We have the mixing. So we have the flavors, neutrinos, which describe production and detection, mass neutrinos, which describe the propagation in between. Obviously, just thinking kind of physically at the quantum mechanical effects which are happening, the three different components of the neutrinos, if they have different masses, they will acquire different phases. And so if you start with a given flavor, at a later time, this phase shift between the different components will lead to a different superposition corresponding to a different flavor of neutrinos. And in fact, we can compute it. So I'll do this computation in detail. Let's say that, for example, we start at initial time with a muon neutrino. This would be the case, for example, in atmospheric neutrino experiments or in accelerator neutrino experiments. So this, as we said, is a coherent superposition of the mass states. How do we evolve it? At a later time, when the neutrino has gone from the source to the detector, then this is simply given by the solution of the Schrödinger equation with the free Hamiltonian. So now we can express this new T in terms of e to the minus I ht. Note that I put h bar and c equal to 1. So e to the minus I ht, h applied to its own eigenstate, will pick up its own eigenvalue, and I end up with this expression here. If I want to know what is the probability that now this neutrino nu mu has oscillated on different flavors, say for instance nu tau at a later time, I project, as we always do in quantum mechanics, this state at a later time onto the flavor I'm interested in, take the modulus squared. In doing so, I express also nu tau in terms of mass states. These are orthonormal states, so this gives me delta ij. When I sum over j, I get this expression. There's an additional simplification I can make. In all the experiments I can think of, neutrinos are highly relativistic, so I can approximate their energy in terms of the common momentum, common energy, and the mass squared, taking the first term in the Taylor expansion of the energy. And so this sum now becomes, depends on this mi squared divided by 2e. Of course, I can then collect an additional term, which is e to the minus I m1 squared divided by 2et. Its modulus is 1, so that also goes away. And I'm left with this expression, which depends on the elements of the PMNS matrix and these terms here, which are generically in the literature called the delta m squares, the difference of the squares of the masses of the neutrinos. There are two, of course, if we have three neutrinos, delta m squared 2-1 and delta m squared 3-1. At least two independent ones. So really, if you want to take away one important message from this colloquium, is that the fact that we have observed neutrino oscillations in which neutrinos go from one flavor to a different one has very important theoretical implications. One is that neutrinos have mass. In fact, if the masses are zero or or they are completely degenerate, then this term would be zero. So this is a one. And now the sum over u alpha I, u beta I, this is zero by unitarity. So the fact that we have seen that this is different from zero means that these masses are different from zero. And of course, this also means that there is mixing. So this unitary matrix cannot be the identity, otherwise either one or two of these terms would be necessarily zero. So this is really very important from a theoretical point of view. And in fact, I mean, one could give a full colloquium looking at the theoretical implications and the searches for models which can explain neutrino masses. Let me just say that kind of the standard picture is that of the seesaw, in which one introduces some new particles, right-handed neutrinos, and then one has both a Dirac mass term and a Majorana mass term for these new particles, which leads to Majorana masses for the light neutrinos. But this is by no means the only possibility. There are many, many different type of models in the literature, including Dirac masses, etc., etc. So that's a very, very interesting area of research, which also has connection with the barium asymmetry, etc. But instead of entering kind of this area of research, what I want to do is give you a broad picture. What is the current knowledge on neutrino properties? So what we have measured, and what are these puzzles that are there? Some of the puzzles are in the context of three-neutrino mixing, and I would say that really the key one here is the leptonic CP violation. And some puzzles instead go beyond the three neutrino picture with the possibility that maybe there other neutrinos exist, so-called sterile neutrinos, or a completely different perspective could be adopted, that of neutrinos strongly linked with dark sectors. So that will be in the second part of my talk. But let's first remain kind of in the standard picture, three neutrino mixing. And what is really remarkable is that 20 years ago, we detected neutrino oscillations, we discovered neutrino oscillations, but in these intervening 20 years, the field has really bloomed. And now we have a very precise picture of neutrino properties with few open questions that I will comment on. So how do you study neutrinos and neutrino oscillations? Well, you go and look for charge current or neutral current interactions in which they can be produced or detected together with charge leptons so that we can identify the flavor of the neutrino. So just to mention the two main ways in which we can produce neutrinos, beta decays, in which electron antineutrinos are produced, or pion decays, in which instead predominantly muon neutrinos or antineutrinos are generated. The decay, in fact, of pions, charged pions into electrons is highly suppressed. And then how you produce them in this way, of course, you can also detect them in the same way. So for instance, in inverse beta decay, an electron antineutrino interacts with a proton to produce a neutron and a positron. So by looking at the positron, one can identify the fact that this is an electron antineutrino to start with. If one had a muon, then we would know that we are dealing with an electron, a muon antineutrino with a tau and tau antineutrino. So in these 20 years, there has been a huge amount of information brought in by many different experiments. I'm mentioning here only some of them, some of the bigger ones, starting from the Snow experiment, Super Kamiokande, which has given important information both on solar neutrinos and atmospheric neutrinos, and Camland on reactor antineutrinos, accelerator neutrinos in the US, for instance, with the NUMI beam, Minos and Nova, T2K, which has Super Kamiokande as its target, and other reactor neutrinos, Diabe, Reno, Double Shaw. So it's as well as other atmospheric neutrino experiments, for instance, ice cubes. So this is an extremely rich picture, and this is what we have learned from it. So we essentially can divide it in different sectors. So the solar sector is where the delta M squared to one, the smallest delta M squared, has been measured, and the corresponding angle theta 1 2. And here the information comes mainly from two sources: solar neutrinos. These are electron neutrinos with quite low energies, energies typically between 0.1 and 10 MeV, and these oscillations are characterized by Mercury effects. And there has been several experiments, starting from Smekanukanda Snow arriving to Borexino, which just ceased operations recently. And essentially, this constrain mainly the mixing angle theta 1 2 to be quite large, but not maximal. In fact, this is significantly different from 45 degrees. And then we have the other piece of information comes from the Camlan experiment, which looked at reactor electron antineutrinos. These again have low energies, 3 MeVs, and but with distances quite long, around 100 kilometers. And Camlan has really been critical in determining the delta M squared to one with very high precision. You see here the value of that Camland kind of brings in, and when you combine everything together, you get this kind of very narrow region, allowed region for the value of these two parameters. Then we have the atmospheric or accelerator neutrino sector. In these experiments, so one can measure the other delta M square, delta M square 3.2 or 3.1, and the angles theta 2.3 and theta 1.3. So for what concerns the larger of the mixing angles, which indeed could be even maximal, theta 2.3, the information is brought in mainly by atmospheric neutrino experiments like Ice Cube and Super Kamiokande, as well as accelerator neutrino experiments like T2K, Nova, as well as Minos. The accelerator neutrino experiments are really targeted to testing these oscillations. So they have very specific distances and corresponding average energies. So for example, T2K has a distance between the source of the neutrinos and the detector of 295 kilometers and an energy of around 700 MeV, while, for example, NOVA has a distance of around 410 kilometers and correspondingly larger energy around 2 GeV. And as you see, they are all broadly consistent, pointing towards a value which is significantly higher. Now, if you see here, this is around 7.5 10 to the minus 5 EV squared, while this is around 2.5 10 to the minus 3 EV squared. So there's a very significant ratio between the two. Obviously, the most important consideration is that, I mean, these are tiny numbers. If you think that the lightest of the charged fermions is the electron and half an MeV, you have, you know, at least 10 to the 6 ratio between the two. So really, neutrinos are special, not just because they have mass, but also because their masses are very, very small. And this seems to indicate, at least to me, that the origin of neutrino masses is somewhat different from that of all the other fermions. And so this indeed was a big surprise. Big surprise that neutrinos have mass in the first place. And the other big surprise is that the masses are nothing like that of the other fermions in the standard model. And if you look at the angles, I already talked about this angle, which is around 45 degrees with some significant uncertainty still. And then we have the third mixing angle, theta 1-3. This was discovered exactly 10 years ago by the Diabay experiment together with Reno, Doubleshaw, and information from T2K. And it has gone from being the unknown mixing angle to the best measured one. And it is small, but not incredibly small. It's around 8 to 9 degrees. So this is another surprise. So somehow in the quark sector, where we have measured the angles very precisely, angles are small. In the lepton sector, these angles are large. I mean, even the smallest one is quite large, but we could have even angles which are maximal. And so this again points to the how special neutrinos, or more in general, in this case, leptonic mixing is. And this kind of opens all another discussion about how to explain this flavor structure. So the leptonic flavor problem and the possibility to have either anarchical anarchy in the entries of the neutrino mass matrix, or something just been done very extensively, the idea of flavor symmetries, in particular discrete symmetries, and in some cases continuous symmetry as well. But again, kind of, this is a theoretical perspective which is very, very interesting, in which neutrinos are giving us really crucial information. So this is a summary of the results, and you see here the values that I already commented on. The one that I haven't talked about yet is the delta phase, so if there is or not leptonic CP violation. This is still a question, very much debated and under very intense experimental scrutiny. And this is the puzzle that we are currently have, in a sense. For several years, up to, let's say, 2019-20, there was kind of increasing indications in favor of leptonic CP violation. And what you would see is, in a plot like this, this is a summary, a global fit of all neutrino data. So we put information from all the different experiments in terms of neutrino oscillations, and go, and then you go and look at what are the allowed ranges, this one sigma to sigma, etc. And CP conservation corresponds to the mixing matrix real, which means delta equal to zero or pi. And over the years, these kind of contours were pointing towards 270 degrees with shrinking and shrinking and shrinking regions. Then what happened is that the Neutrino 2020 conference, the results from the NOVA and T2K experiments were put forward. And somehow these indications kind of stopped. And now we are really in a situation a little bit of uncertainty concerning leptonic CP violation. We really have to wait new results. I remind you that if you are interested in this, in a month's time, couple of weeks, there will be the Neutrino 2022 conference, in which all the major experiments will report their new results. So I'm very curious to see what will be the situation after the new results are presented. And The way you determine that the CP violation at present is by looking at the oscillations on nu mu into nu e neutrinos. I'll comment a little bit on that later on. Now, if you try to fit the oscillation probability with an experiment like T2K sees, that depends on two parameters, theta 1,3 and the delta phase. And so you find these kind of big contours here. But we have information on theta 1,3 coming from reactor neutrino experiments, and that has no dependence on the delta phase. So in this kind of parameter space, will appear as simply as a very constrained line here. And so then this allows you to determine with more precision the value of the delta phase. And what has happened is that T2K and NOVA have opposite preference for the CP violating phase. So if you look at normal ordering of neutrino masses, then NOVA prefers the this range of phases here, while T2K prefers these. So it's not really that there are indications in the same direction towards the value of pi. It's just that NOVA and T2K prefer opposite regions. And so when you try to fit them all together, you go in the middle where the value of pi is. I think it's quite striking when you look at the allowed ranges for the delta phase between NOVA and T2K, and essentially they are exactly opposite. So this is very much an area in which we expect the surprises. We could actually observe CP violation in by the end of this decade, and this would be a result of really very high importance. So what have we learned out of this, all these experiments? Well, that we have three massive neutrinos. We can arrange their masses in two ways. And this is the so-called normal ordering, because it resembles what happens in the quark sector, in which the two lightest ones are separated by the small delta m square. And instead, this is the inverted ordering, where it is the two heavier ones. And you can express then the three masses in terms of the ordering and the overall mass scale. So let me kind of very briefly go through what are the open questions and how can we answer them. So the first and one that I have not talked about so far is the nature of neutrinos, whether they're Dirac or Majorana particles. We want to know the values of the masses, not just the mass square differences. This requires the overall scale and the ordering. And we have this big question concerning the leptonic CP, whether it is conserved or not. And what I'm going to talk at the end is if this standard picture of neutrinos is actually all there is, or neutrinos have other surprises in store for us. What is really exciting is that there is a very broad program experience, many of which are already running, like T2K, NOVA, Microbone, Icarus is starting to take data, Catherine, Quore just released the latest results, and with new experiments being constructed. And we have some many new experiments under construction. In particular, let me mention T2HK and DUNE, which are big accelerator neutrino experiments, which are under construction now and should start in a matter of 4 or 5 years from now. So let me go through some of these questions. First of all, I was talking about the nature of neutrinos. For me, this is really a very fundamental question. And the difference between Majorana and Dirac particles is that while for Dirac particles, you can distinguish the particle from the antiparticle, and this is the case of the electron, for example. Electron and positron are distinguishable because they have different opposite charge. Now, a Majorana particle is a particle in which instead you cannot distinguish particle from antiparticle. And this could be the case of neutrinos. Indeed, these are the only standard model fermions could be of Majorana type, because they are, of course, the only neutral ones. Now, how can you distinguish a neutrino if it is a Dirac particle? Well, you distinguish neutrino from antineutrino because of a conserved lepton number. Neutrino is lepton number one, antineutrino is lepton number minus one. If this distinction is not there, then it means that lepton number has no meaning. It's not a conserved symmetry of nature. And so that's why this question for me is so important, because it relates to the conservation or lack of lepton number, and then is the information we need to guide our exploration of the theory beyond the standard model at the origin of neutrino masses. Now, the most sensitive way we have to test this property, the nature of neutrinos, is neutrinoless double beta decay. This is a process in which simultaneously two neutrons decay into two protons and two electrons, exchanging one of these light massive Majorana neutrinos. The lifetime depends on the neutrino properties, in particular depends on the neutrino masses, the mixing angles, and these Majorana phases that are still unknown, so need to be treated as unknown parameters. So what one can try to do is to look at the information we have already on neutrino masses to get a prediction for this, which is called effective Majorana mass parameter. And then this will give us a prediction for the lifetime of this process. And then we can compare with experimental sensitivities. And this is the typical plot one finds in this type of research, where this is the effective Majorana mass parameter that I showed you earlier. And this depends on the ordering of the masses. So we have inverted ordering in this blue region here, and normal ordering if instead you are in the gray, in the green region, and depends on the overall scale of the neutrino. So if neutrino masses are quite large, one gets kind of these largish values of the effective Majorana mass parameter. With inverted ordering, the bound is significant, around 10 to 15 millielectron volts. And instead, if it is normal hierarchical spectrum, down here, the bounds are much smaller. And of course, this corresponds to longer and longer and longer lifetimes, and so more and more advanced experiments to test them. In fact, if we can compare here with experimental sensitivities, right now we are roughly in this range, so we are testing the quasi-degenerate spectrum going into the inverted ordering. And importantly, there are many experiments which are planned for the coming future, which aim to reach this 10 millielectron volt region and to test completely the case of inverted ordering. Whatever the ordering is, the moment we find a positive signal in neutrinoless double beta decay, this would be of momentous importance because it would indicate lepton number violation and Majorana neutrinos. Of course, these are extremely difficult experiments. First of all, you have to look at nuclei where single beta decay is not allowed because of kinematics. So if the parent nucleus is lighter than the daughter nucleus for a single beta decay, then this cannot proceed. Otherwise, just the rate of two random single beta decays in coincidence could mimic this signature. So there are a handful of these type of nuclei: germanium 76, molybdenum 100, tellurium 130, xenon 136. So already you have to look for a very specific nuclei. In addition to that, there is a standard model process, which is the one in which instead of exchanging a Majorana neutrino here, one emits the two electron antineutrinos. This is the two neutrino double beta decay. And this is a background, a necessary background for this type of searches. So one needs to go to extremely precise low background experiments. These are typically in deep underground labs, for example, at Gran Sasso, with very large masses, extremely good energy resolution, and an extreme reduction of background. I mean, I was amazed that one day I was reading through this, and I found that in order to reduce the backgrounds, one has to shield the detector, but normal lead is too radioactive for that. So you need to use lead which has not been activated by cosmic rays. And so one can go and look at the lead in sank Roman ships, which has stayed for 2000 years after hundreds of meters of water, which have absorbed the cosmic rays and therefore are much less radioactive than normal lead. This is the level of ingenuity that these type of experiments need to achieve. And these are the latest results. So the most sensitive ones are already since a few years, Kamlan-Zen results with this beta beta around 60 to 160 millielectron volt. And these are the results by the Quarry collaboration. We just last week presented the latest results from in Nature with a lifetime of around 2.9, 10 to the 25 years. What is very exciting, as I already mentioned, is that there is all this plan of new experiments coming up. And here I give you a broad overview. As I said, they all aim to 50 to 20 millielectron volts. Now, in terms of measuring neutrino masses, one has beta decays, and the scattering experiments are taking data, looking at a deviation of the spectrum right at the end in beta decays. One looks at the electrons, measures the energy very, very precisely, and one sees if there is this distortion at the end, which would signal the presence of neutrino masses. We can get some information from neutrinos about beta decay, and cosmology provides, at the moment, the strongest constraints on neutrino masses, on the sum in particular of neutrino masses, although assuming a given cosmological model. If instead we're looking at the mass ordering, neutrino oscillations are particularly suited for that, either exploiting matter effects or in vacuum. These are various strategies with ORCA and KM3Net, IceCube, Hyperchemical Day and INO, or the Juno experiment looking at reactor neutrinos. And the way we search for the normal or inverted mass ordering in long baseline experiments is looking at the nu mu into nu e oscillations, where this is kind of an approximate formula which explains the physics behind it. So the dominant term comes in with suppression due to the smallest mixing angle, which we said is not too small after all. But this depends on matter effects, because neutrinos, as they travel through the Earth, they feel the background and acquire an effective mass as photons do in a plasma. This effective mass is different for neutrinos and antineutrinos because the background is different. So we have only a background of particles, not antiparticles. And so these effects are opposite for neutrinos and antineutrinos. And this can enhance or suppress the oscillation probability. And then there are these, the second term, subdominant but relevant, is the one due to CP violation. So this, by measuring these effects, one can try to deduce if the value of delta is zero or pi or different from it. And this is why we have this interdependence in the oscillation probability between theta 1,3 and delta, which I mentioned when I explained how we are extracting the value of the delta phase from these experiments. There are two running that I already mentioned, T2K and NOVA, and there are the two kind of ultimate experiments in this area, which are T2HK and DUNE, T2HK in Japan and DUNE in the US. And these are the typical sensitivities, but just to tell that, independent of the value of the delta phase, the DUNE experiment will discover the ordering of neutrino masses. So by the end of this decade, we should have this question answered. And concerning CP violation is the same, it will take a few years more. As far as the delta phase is sufficiently different from zero or pi, again, we should have the discovery of leptonic CP violation in the next, let's say, 10 years or a little bit more or so. The last comment I want to make on this before going into beyond three neutrino mixing and really the puzzles which are there at present, concerns the fact that we have really different sources of different experimental strategies to measure these experiments. And it's really in combining all this together that we have a very coherent and clear picture of neutrino properties is emerging. Is there everything there is? So I'm going to spend the last 15 minutes to talk about puzzles, which really intrigue me a lot. And I'm waiting eagerly for the Neutrino 2022 conference, where we have new results by most of the experiments I'm going to mention. Is there something beyond three neutrino mixing? First of all, is that a completely unrealistic theoretical extension? Well, not really, because if we think of any new particle, which is a neutral fermion, This could mix with the normal neutrinos if there's no symmetry which distinguishes them. And therefore, if there is mixing, then this could show up. They could have consequences, experimental consequences. Indeed, these type of neutral fermions, they are called sterile neutrinos, as far as they don't have any standard model interaction. And they could mix via now a 4x4 rather than 3x3 mixing matrix with the massive neutrinos. Generically, I will talk about nu4, which is the mass state, so it's a nearly sterile neutrino, although very typically it's called a sterile neutrino in the literature. From a theoretical point of view, this is a very natural extension. The theory remains anomaly-free, can give masses to neutrinos in the CISO models, for example, while indeed introduces right-handed neutrinos with neutrino masses. If they are very, very heavy, they can be embedded in gap theories, but they could be even much lighter. And in fact, there is not a unique theoretical perspective on this. You can explain why they are very light in terms of natural mass. If you set their mass to zero, you recover the U1 symmetry, so they are technically natural. They could be very, very heavy embedded in the gap scale. But I would say that from a theoretical perspective, that's my view, anywhere in between is perfectly allowed. If you're looking at light sterile neutrinos, so EV scale, they will enter into neutrino oscillations through these oscillations probabilities, similar to the ones that I already told you. And in this case,
sorry, Silvia, we don't hear you very well. Maybe the microphone, you just touched something.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Much better, thank you.
Okay. So if you're now looking at these oscillation probabilities, they depend on m4 squared minus m1 squared. So they set this scale of the mass of the fourth neutrino. And they depend on now the mixing angles. So these elements of the mixing matrix, this big 4x4 matrix, or even more if we have three of these sterile neutrinos. And here there are puzzles aplenty. So we start from some anomalies in the 80s and 90s, which somehow have kind of disappeared from the discussion, but they were in various experiments. They were subsequently tested, and in the context of neutrino oscillation, somehow they were excluded. But they are very puzzling and very interesting. But the one which somehow survived from the 90s to today is the LSND one. So in these experiments, one produced pions, which decayed into muons and nu mus, and the muons decayed into positrons, nuis, and importantly, anti-nu mus, with the spectrum shown here. Now, and one looked for the oscillations of anti-nu mus into anti-nuis, because it's easy to detect these energies. Now, this is the ion decay at rest, so we're talking about tens of MeV. So it's very easy to detect, compared to the others, it's easy to detect electron antineutrinos via inverse beta decay. It's a very specific signature which involves only electron antineutrinos. And so they looked at the number of events, and this is the events as a function of L over E, because they had minor neutrino oscillations. And these colored regions are the backgrounds, and these points here are the events. So you see a significant excess on top of the backgrounds. Now, the distance between, so the energies are these 10-20 MeV, the distance is very, very short between the source and the detector. These are roughly 30 meters or so. Now, if you have, in order to have oscillations at such so distance from this formula here, you see that you need a delta M squared, which is quite large. It needs to be in the EV region rather than 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 5 EV squared, as we talked about earlier. So this clearly is an indication that you need a fourth neutrino, a sterile neutrino. So what you do at that point, but you build a new experiment to test, so under control conditions, so where you know very well the beam, the detector, etc. So the plan was to build a Boone experiment. But as you see, what was built is a mini Boone experiment. So what happened? So you produce the neutrinos from pion decay, so you have a beam of nu mu neutrinos. And then ideally you have a near detector where you normalize the flux and you look at all systematic errors and backgrounds. And then you have a far detector where you look at the oscillations, and by doing this near far ratio, you have a very clear indication of oscillations. By mini boon, you can guess already that only the near detector was built, and this led to its own anomaly. This goes under the name of the mini boon low energy excess, which very intriguingly increased in significance with more data and more refined analysis, going from 3.6 sigma in 2008 to the latest results a couple of years ago at nearly 5 sigma. So what is the excess? So this, this is the number of events, of E-like events, so mu E's. The idea is that you look for new mu into new oscillations at these relatively short distances, and this is as a function of the energy. All the color part of these bins are backgrounds. For example, the green are the new E's, which are intrinsic in the beam itself. The pi zeros are in red here, these other backgrounds are the deltas. But you see, on top of the background, you have this excess of events. And if you try to fit it within a neutrino oscillation picture, indeed, it is compatible with LSND. But now, in this second part of the talk, I will give a lot of my own personal comments. If you look at the fit of the data of this excess, which are these kind of points going towards low energy, in terms of neutrino oscillations, I mean, the fit is not really great. It doesn't really, oscillations are not able to give you a very good fit to the lower energy part. Of course, errors are still quite large, so it's still perfectly compatible and acceptable. Now, there were also many experiments which looked at disappearance. So instead of looking at new mu into new E, so the change in flavor, you look for new mu's into new mu's, and you see if you have a deficit compared to your predictions. And here there was a variety of experiments. Let me mention just Minos, Minos Plus, CDHS, microboon, it's a mini boon itself, as well as more recent experiments like Supercomicand and Ice Cube. And typically, they bring very strong bounds on the mixing angle between muon neutrinos and this nearly sterile neutrino, nu 4, very strong at the level of around 10 to minus 4. How about the electron sector? I mean, this is even more puzzling because there were anomalies here, which are still unexplained. So potentially we might be seeing neutrino oscillations in this area. There is the so-called reactor anomaly. So one goes and looks at the flux of reactor antineutrinos very close to the reactor. And this seems to indicate a significant lower flux than expected. Then what you do, you build new experiments where you try to test this. And there are many. Let me mention NEOS, Prospect, Stereo, Dance, Neutrino 4. And some of them kind of put strong bounds. Some of them see strange patterns. For example, this is the Neutrino 4 results. This is the number of observed events over essentially the predictions, and you see this oscillatory pattern, which would require a delta m squared of 7 EV squared. But if you now try to look at how they all fit together, they don't. I mean, the picture is really incoherent at the moment. For example, the new four result, this is 2 sigma, call for neutrino masses around here with a very large mixing angle, but mixing angle which is excluded, for example, the best prospect experiment and by the solar neutrino experiments as well. So this is all very puzzling. We have to wait for new results. And if you want even more puzzling results, these are the gallium anomaly, which looks at flux of neutrinos measured into the gallium in gallium. And if you look at that, this is significantly lower than what you expect. And there was an experiment which presented data very, very recently, BEST, which uses a chromium source and exactly looks for these new E's interactions on gallium. And what they see is much less than what they expect. And now if you try to fit all this together, again, it doesn't fit. This is in tension with solar neutrino data at roughly 3 sigma. So the picture is very open, I would say, and rather incoherent at the moment. If you try to fit the information from muon and electroneutrino experiments together with mini boon and LSMD is even more complicated, because in particular the new mu disappearance experiments put a very strong bound on u mu 4, but you need u mu 4 to explain in mini boon and LSMD the oscillations from new mu's into new e's, and so there is a very strong tension there. In fact, it doesn't fit together, and if you put all this in the context of cosmologies, well, is even more puzzling, because these neutrinos with this very large mixing angles would have been produced very copiously in the Lie universe and would have thermalized. So they would count as a fourth species of neutrinos, but that is actually constrained by cosmology, at least in standard lambda CDM cosmology, and it's not possible. You cannot have a fully thermalized fourth neutrino with the type of masses that we're talking about, which are well above 1 eV. The bound, in fact, on this is below 0.5 or around 0.5 electron volt, depending on the analysis. So what you do then, you have a dedicated experimental program which tests this. And in fact, you can use the booster beam, the same as mini boon, but now with a detector which sees very well neutrinos, in particular electron neutrinos, so that you can distinguish by the topology an electron from a pi zero from a single photon, and so that you can really say, oh yes, all these backgrounds of pi zeros, delta, etc., that could affect the mini boon results are perfect, under perfect control, and we see only the electron neutrinos. So this is already an event by microboon, a beautiful event. And Icarus, which is another liquid argon detector using the same beam line, is now starting to take in data at Fermilab. And soon we should have also a near detector, because it's important to have near and far detectors in these experiments, called SBND. These are all in the range of a few hundred meters. Now, last October, we had the first results from microboon. This was quite exciting. The first question they wanted to answer was if the miniboon results were due to electrons or photons, because miniboon, by the type of detector it is, it's a liquid scintillator detector, is not really able to distinguish electrons from photons and from pi zeros, etc. So they looked at the pi zero background, measured, cannot explain the excess. They looked at the dirt events, not possible to explain the excess. They focused on photons, which could be produced by a standard model interaction coming from delta resonance, of which we don't know the cross-section very well. So if the cross-section is off by a little bit, by a factor of 3, really, this could have explained this excess. There are these brownish events here. And the answer was this. I was really very waiting very, very excited with these events. And the answer is this. This is what they observe, and this would be what they should observe if indeed the low energy excess is explained by this type of standard model delta resonance photons. So my take on this one, of course, this is still a relatively large error bar, but it's quite far off from what you would need. So my opinion on this, that it's unlikely that this is the explanation of the low energy miniboon excess. Then the second question you ask is, then is this miniboon low energy excess due to electrons? So essentially due to nu mu into nu e oscillations, and then nu e scatters in the detector producing electrons. And this is the result. This is the observed events over the predicted ones. So the red is the one predicted if you want to explain the low energy excess, and these are the data points. Again, I mean, it depends on the analysis, the statistics is still low, so we still have to wait new results. But the picture which is emerging from this is it doesn't look like that indeed you have oscillations at play. So it's not standard model, it's not neutrino oscillations. So what is it then? And I want to, if I can have 5 more minutes, I want to propose a different perspective on this. And the mini boon events, as I said, are electron-like. but you cannot distinguish them, for example, from an E plus E minus pair, in which the E plus E minus are either rather overlapping, or one is very, very soft, carries very little energy, so the detector cannot see it, and then you will see only one electron or positron. And how could you produce this type of events? Well, if you have a new extension of the standard model, and this relates to these dark sectors that I mentioned at the very beginning of the colloquium, you could have new mu, the new mu's coming from the B. Now they could interact in the detector itself, but you need an enhanced interaction compared to the standard model one. So there needs to be a new particle, a Z prime, for example, a dark photon or a dark scalar. And then this could produce a one of these heavy sterile neutrinos or nearly sterile neutrinos, which can decay very fast, because now this is also enhanced as you enhance the production, you also enhance their decay, producing an E plus E minus pair. And this is what you see in terms of either overlapping E plus E minus or highly asymmetric ones. And in fact, we have shown that this provides a very good picture in the context of fully self-consistent theoretical models, which call for a rather rich extension of the standard models. You have new interactions, for example, a Z prime or a dark scalar. You have new fermions, which are charged under these new interactions. So, and you have, you also assume that there will be a dark scalar which breaks the U1 symmetry, giving mass to the dark photon. So in a sense, is a dark sector version of the structure of the standard model with a cage symmetry, a fermionic content, and a scalar structure. The phenomenology is extremely interesting. I cannot really go into the details of that. I just want to mention that these type of models can explain other anomalies as well. For example, the G-2-1, but due to time, I cannot really go into the last part of my talk is that if this is true, if we are seeing the first hints of dark sector, this would be a major result. This would indicate that the standard model has, at least at low energy, an extension with new particles and new interactions, what go under the name of dark sectors or hidden sectors, which could also include the dark matter. These dark sectors can talk to the standard model in a variety of ways, with the kinetic, with vector portal, neutrino portal, scalar portal. And in this, neutrinos can really play a crucial role because they can mix with the neutral fermions of the dark sectors and the sterile neutrinos. And in this way, they can interact with the dark sector, potentially producing unique experimental signatures like the ones that I discussed. And with this kind of I close, neutrinos are really extremely interesting particles. They are most elusive and mysterious of the known fermions. And importantly, neutrino masses and mixing are the only particle physics evidence we have so far of physics beyond the standard model. So we have already gone from the discovery of neutrino oscillations to a very kind of detailed and precise picture of neutrino properties. There are still some questions open. The neutrino mass ordering, leptonic CP violation. And of course, there are hints, intriguing hints in the electron neutrino sector, in with mini boon and the low energy excess. And we are waiting now new information to see if some light kind of is a more coherent picture emerges out of this. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Silvia. Very clear and interesting talk. We can now ask if there are questions from the audience. People can put up their hands. And meanwhile, maybe people think I can start with a question. You showed this plot of the comparison in the delta and the measurement of delta between the T2K and the NOVA experiments, where they don't agree with each other. And so my question is, are they still compatible at how many sigma did the two measurements? So can this be just a statistical fluctuation So maybe with more data, it will be resolved, or we really need some systematics in one of the two experiments.
Yeah, indeed. No, okay, you see here, this is 90%. So, you know, at this level, they are still perfectly compatible. You know, you have a tension at really less than two sigma. So it's still early days. But this in a month's time, we will have new information. So for me, it will be important to see if somehow this pattern remains there, or you are really seeing some statistical fluctuation. And if we see kind of some a reduction of this tension, that would be indicating something in that direction. So that's very, very interesting. Somehow, it depends also a little bit on how they do the analysis, and also critically, it depends on the ordering. So the NOVA results would be perfectly compatible with the T2K ones if the, the ordering is inverted. Now, for the inverted ordering, T2K results don't really depend much on the ordering, because the baseline is too short to be sensitive to matter effects. And so, while in NOVA, that is not the case. And instead, you see here, this is the case for inverted ordering, and this is instead the significance of the value of the delta phase for normal ordering. So, essentially, for normal ordering, these values of the delta phase, which are the ones preferred by T2K, are excluded at around two sigma. So this is the level of the discrepancy. But you have information from the normal ordering from atmospheric neutrinos, which instead prefer normal ordering. So okay. That's why we have to wait and see the new results.
And how much will these new results now reduce the uncertainty? What should we expect?
There is another couple of years of data taking, so they cannot expect.
I was meaning like in the next month, in the new conference result.
Yeah. So between 2020-22, there's gonna be the analysis of couple of years of data. If they all went together in the same direction, we would have reached around three sigma. As indications of leptonic CP violation. So now, as there is this tension, we will remain at the level of two sigma or so, but it's important to see the trend of the data.
And there is a question by Theo. You can unmute yourself, I think. Maybe not, maybe I have to try now.
Hi, thank you for this interesting talk and broad overview. Of course, we have a lot of troubles in physics, and we hope that they will all be solved. So speaking about sterile neutrinos, my question is, would they help, or can they help for solving the muon G minus two problem?
Okay, so it depends on the kind of extensions you are looking at. So if you're looking just at sterile neutrinos, they don't really play much of a role. However, they can enter other type of processes, like for example, mu 2 e gamma, so lepton flavor violating processes. So there they can play a role, but not daylight sterile neutrinos I talked about, because in that case, you have a kind of G mechanism which is broken by the masses. So you need quite heavy masses. So if they are kind of in the GV range, then they can start playing a role there. So these very light sterile neutrinos don't play a role in G minus two, but they could, if you're talking about the kind of extensions I was mentioning earlier, these dark sector extensions. Because generically in dark sectors, so the G minus two explanation in terms of kinetic mixing is actually excluded. But the bounds that you have, in particular from Babar, which constrain this kinetic mixing to be quite small, are very much relaxed if you have this kind of dark sector models of this kind, because the Z primes, the dark photons in this kind of models decay neither visibly nor invisibly. They have somewhat an intermediate way. I call them semi-visible. So they produce visible particles, but missing energy. And because of that, the bounds get relaxed. So if you want, there is a connection with sterile neutrinos, but now we're talking about relatively heavy sterile neutrinos, and hundreds of MeVs or GV neutrinos, and then they would enter. They would enter into kind of dark sector explanations of G-2, as well as lepton flare evaluating processes.
Okay, thank you. And then there's the connection of kilo electron volt neutrinos and sterile neutrinos, of course, and warm dark matter. Do you have, can you say something about this, or is this something that...
Yes, that's very, very interesting. So these, in this case, we're talking about sterile neutrinos with KeV masses. And as you mentioned, these are warm dark matter candidates because they are a little bit too fast when LASK structure forms to be cold dark matter, but they are not as fast as hot dark matter. So structure formation is somewhat similar to cold dark matter on very large scales, but it's a bit suppressed at small scales. So these sterile neutrinos require very small mixing angles because they need to be quasi-stable on cosmological timescales. So we're typically talking about few KeV masses and mixing of the order of sine squared 2 theta around 10 to minus 10 or so, 10 to minus 11. So what is interesting is that, first of all, they could be produced easily in the early universe just by mixing, although in that case, the spectrum is a bit too hot to really be warm dark matter. So one has to look at alternatives, but you know, in many extensions, it's relatively easy to produce them. And then they can decay via this tiny mixing they have. And they can decay into, the main decay channel is the three neutrinos, but they can also decay into neutrino and photon. Although the branching ratio is only 1%, this is a very clear signature because you have a particle essentially at rest, which decays into two particles. So the energy of the photon is equal to half the mass of the neutrino, of the sterile neutrino. You know, so this gives a very, very clear signature in X-ray searches where you point towards high density regions of dark matter, for example, dwarf galaxies, and then you look for a line in the X-ray spectrum. And in fact, there are some puzzles there as well, because there was an indication which was quite debated. Different groups came up with different analyses, but looking at some galaxies, if I remember, it was maybe the Perseus and some other galaxies, there was an excess, a little bump around 3.5 keV, indicating potentially a sterile neutrino dark matter with a 7 keV mass. And so the experiment, which was kind of expected to solve this, unfortunately, was a satellite which blew up. And so we are waiting now for new results, and that will clarify this issue. Indeed, if you see that signature, it would be quite remarkable and very, very interesting.
Okay, thank you.
And other questions, sir? I had another one, if I can still steal you some time, on the reactor neutrino anomaly and the gallium. So if I understood correctly, the four neutrino picture is excluded by oscillation data, of like you show the plot, right? So can instead the tension be, say, the anomaly in the sense, be explained consistently with the oscillation, with other oscillation data in other scenarios, like with more neutrinos or more stellar neutrinos, or with the different in physics?
Yeah, so this reactor anomaly is, so if you extend to more stellar neutrinos, it doesn't really help much. Although it's a very confusing picture. Maybe this is the plot which clarifies this better. So the neutrino 4 likes this yellow region here. Now, dance has this bound. Neos, you see, they also see some kind of potential oscillations, but it doesn't really reach neutrino 4. So they are not really compatible between themselves. So you could argue maybe there are multiple sterile neutrinos, and we are seeing the effects of several that I don't really know. Actually, I was preparing this talk and I was looking at this process. I mean, could that be an explanation? In terms of the reactor neutrino anomaly itself, it's true that there is this deficit, if you want, of neutrinos compared to the predictions. But one has to keep in mind that the predictions are very difficult. These, the computation of the reactor neutrino fluxes is a very complex issue, which has to take into account all the different radioactive elements which build up over time in a reactor, etc. And in recent years, there has been some results from the Kuchatov Institute, which somehow has constrained better the flux that we expect from uranium-235. And this seems to increase, or better, decrease the prediction by a level of 5% or so. So that now the reactor anomaly, if one takes this into account, goes down to maybe a 2 sigma level or so.
Okay, thank you. There another question by Stefan Lavignac. Sorry, I should unmute you.
Okay. Hi, Silvia.
Hi.
Thanks for this talk. Since you mentioned several times the neutrino experiment, this experiment has been very strongly criticized by many people, including especially experimentalists, no? So should one really take their results or the result of their analysis seriously?
Okay, so if you're talking about all these experiments, is this what you mean?
I'm talking about specifically the neutrino 4 experiment.
Yes. No, I agree.
The claimed result.
Yes. So no, I completely agree. And these are very difficult experiments because typically you have these reactors. Usually they are quite compact. And then one goes and looks at the flux of neutrinos as a distance of few meters. And so apart from systematic errors and geometry issues, et cetera, what you would really want to see is the development of the oscillation, so measuring this at different distances. In terms of neutrino 4, I completely agree. And in fact, it doesn't really fit. They are particularly in strong tension with the solar neutrino results. So as I said, this is a very incoherent picture. And I think what we have to wait is for the results coming up in a month and a half, and that I think will shed some further light. In fact, in a way, I mean, these sterile neutrinos could be there, but it's unlikely that would have such large mixing angles. And in fact, I completely agree with you. Experimentally, there are some issues which need to be taken into account. There is also this best result. I find this also quite puzzling. Again, I looked at the analysis. I mean, it seems a very comprehensive and detailed analysis. But again, also here, we are not really looking at, in this case, an L dependence of the signature. You just see an overall deficit at two different distances, but it's still an overall deficit in the two detectors. So it's unclear really if this indicates neutrino oscillations. Also, these are in strong tension with the solar neutrino data. So, I mean, my expectation is somehow this clears up and we push these bounds on the mixing angle to much smaller values, but neutrinos tend to provide surprises very so often, so I would not bet on it.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Are there other questions? If not, I think maybe Silvia, if there are questions that people will put on the form, on the Google form in the website, if there are any, then maybe Silvia, you can try to answer
that. Absolutely, sure.
Okay, otherwise, thank you again for this nice talk. And bye-bye. Everybody have a nice evening.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.